The guitar is one of the most popular instruments of all time. Millions have been made in countless varieties. Yet to find the one which meets your desires for richness of tone, balance, and personal style can be an unending search, and to have a custom instrument made can cost thousands of dollars. One alternative is to construct your own guitar. These instruments are unique in their own special way. All of these guitars are first attempts. The more we research methods of guitar making, the more we realize that there are several ways to construct a fine instrument. We read books, bought plans, and enrolled in a guitar making class. This video documents our first efforts. As you watch this program, we will show you every step and most of the problems we encountered as first-time builders, along with suggesting some alternative methods to help you make your own personal guitar.
We chose to build a couple of flat-top acoustic guitars, a steel-string dreadnought and an island-string classical. The development of the guitar spent several hundred years, but the evolution of these two basic types occurred in different continents at about the same time. During the middle 19th century, guitar design was primarily influenced by two master luthiers. The mellow sound of the classical, or Spanish guitar as we know it, was developed by Antonio de Torres Curado in Spain, while the bright sounding steel string guitar was manufactured in America by Christian Frederick Martin Sr. At the time these two distinctly different guitars were being developed, America was experiencing the Industrial Revolution. Consequently, many of the techniques used for steel string guitars were borrowed from the production line of the new American factories. But the Industrial Revolution didn't reach Europe until after the guitar was developed there. And even now, over 100 years after Torres created his masterpieces, many of the finest classical guitars are still being made by hand in the old Spanish method.
We started by making a plastic template. The template shows half of the guitar's outline. It's used in several stages of construction and is also helpful in choosing the woods. You can make the template by tracing an existing plan, copying the body of a guitar that has a pleasing contour, or by creating your own design. Once the outline was scratched into a piece of transparent plastic, about an eighth inch thick, we sawed out the template just outside of the line. We cut the template using a bandsaw, but when we tried using a coping saw or a jigsaw on the other templates, we ran into problems and found that the plastic started to split. A simple solution is to tape the plastic onto a piece of composite board. This gives enough support to eliminate any cracking. To finish the template, we filed down to the scratch line and cut a notch to mark the center. Now that we decided on the size and shape of our guitars, we had to choose the woods. For these two guitars, we used the same types of woods to demonstrate how different instruments can be made out of the same raw materials.
We visited the Luthiers Mercantile to see what is available to the guitar maker and bought our materials there. If you're an experienced woodworker and want to cut your own wood, you should follow the procedure used by luthier suppliers. Look for quarter sawn billets. Watch out for the grain runout, a characteristic of wood that wasn't properly cut, especially on the top. Some builders go so far as to split the wood to ensure straight grain. To store the wood, especially if you suspect it is still green, seal the end grain with paraffin after re-sawing and place the wood on stickers to air dry. Begin your construction only when you're sure that the moisture content of the wood is stabilized. The topper soundboard is set into vibration by the strings. It needs to be flexible enough to resonate and brace properly to avoid distortion under the pull of the strings. To achieve a visually symmetrical balance, the top is made of two book match pieces made by re-sawing a billet of wood and then matching them up along the grain and gluing the edges. This important piece of the guitar is usually made of a soft wood, such as spruce, cedar, or redwood. A widely accepted choice is spruce, and we chose to use Sitka spruce, which comes from Alaska and Pacific Northwest. The sides and back are often made of a hardwood in order to reflect the sound and amplify the volume. Woods commonly used include koa, Brazilian rosewood, mahogany, flame maple, and Indian rosewood. The wood is chosen for acoustic properties and beauty. The back is also traditionally made of book match halves, although 3- and 4-piece backs are also common. Brazilian rosewood is considered to be the best material for the size and back. Unfortunately, this wood is difficult to get and very expensive, so we decided on Indian rosewood. This beautiful wood is easy to work, has excellent acoustic properties, and is becoming the choice for first-rate instruments. The neck needs strength, stability, and lightweight. Certain species of maple, cedar, and mahogany meet these requirements. We used Honduran mahogany and found that carving the neck out of this wood was very easy. The fingerboard is also made out of a hardwood. We used ebony. Some other choices include maple, rosewood, and synthetic materials such as phenolic. Ebony is a good choice because of its hardness and resistance to oil and sweat from the player's hand. Materials for bracing, linings, bindings, purfling, bridge, and other parts need to be considered after the major parts are selected. Here you see all of the materials which go into the construction of a single guitar.
Some luthiers hand-build guitars in a complete free-form method. On the other hand, most factories use elaborate jigs and molds. We used a simple form to help us maintain symmetry and ensure the accuracy of our construction. All of the material used in making a working board, bracing board, female form, and bending form came from a single 4x8 piece of composition board. You will use 6 layers of board for the bending form. To determine the minimum thickness of the composition board you will need, measure the thickest segment of the guitar you will build and divide by 6. A 3/4 inch thickness will work for a 4.5 inch thick steel string. On the classical model, we were able to use a 5/8 inch board. A large dreadnought design will require a shim or even an extra layer to avoid using boards over 3/4 inch.
We divided the board into 6 sections measuring 18 by 22 inches, one with a 4 by 16th inch neck and a 25 by 23 inch piece. After finding the center of the boards, we drew a center line and extended the lines down the edges of the boards. We then used a plastic template to lay out the guitar outline. This simple drawing tool was constructed out of some scrap board. It helped in drawing 1/2 inch lines around the outline. Don't worry too much about accuracy here. The inside line is the one that determines the guitar's shape. The long side of the drawing tool marks 2.5 inches from the template and was used on the 25 by 23 inch board. After laying out this board, we connected the belts with a straight line.
Next, we glued together stacks of 2 and 3 18 by 22 inch boards. Apply glue very liberally, but only in the area 2 inches in and 1 inch outside of the outermost line. We used alphetic resin on the form, but you can use a good quality polyvinyl acetate, white glue. After aligning the boards, we secured them with nails at the corners to prevent any sliding when we applied pressure. Once the glue set, we lined up the 2 stacks and drilled the 5 boards so that we could use a couple of 3/8 inch dowels to line up the stacks.
The boards were sawn out on a bandsaw using a 3/8 inch skip or hook tooth blade. The form now looks like a large version of the guitar body. In the next step, the center line is redrawn on the edges for alignment. We removed the dowels and separated the stacks. We used one of the stacks as a drill guide on the 25 by 23 inch board. Next, we spread out a bead of glue, replaced the pins, and put the larger board between the stacks. The purpose of this board is to give the form strength and make the form easy to clamp into a vise. We added a bracket to the form. This allows the bandsaw to enter when we cut out the inside of the form. This is the most delicate operation. A precise cut is essential, and to make it, you must have the table of the bandsaw square and your blade sharp. We also made a cut about 1/8 inch deep on the opposite side of the bracket, which we used later when we trimmed the sides. We removed the cutout section and sawed it down the center line. Then we drew about 1/2 inch in and cut. At this point, we separated a single layer. Now you can see why we didn't spread the glue too far inside of the glue lines. We glued this board and the bending form was finished.
To mark the taper of the sound box, we made this tool out of some clamps. With the pen set to the maximum thickness of the body, raise the neck end and mark the desired taper. We found that a small jigsaw easily cut out the taper, provided the saw was small enough to fit inside the upper bouts. You could also use a power sander, plane, rasp, or chisel. A power sander helped smooth out the form, and a long flat board made sanding on the edges go more quickly. To true up the forms, we attached some sandpaper on a flat surface and made a large sanding board. This method ensured that our forms were smooth and even. From the remaining composition board, we marked off a base for bracing the top and the back, and a board to align the neck. The hole in the bracing board allows flexibility during clamping. We trimmed the neck of the alignment board to the proper length just before using it. The form gets somewhat damp during the side bending process, and we learned that varnish works well to seal up the forms. This prevents the porous composition board from swelling up with moisture and added some strength. Now that we have our forms completed, an important part in our preparation is accomplished, and we can start on the actual construction of the guitars.
The top and back of the guitar are made of bookmatch pieces, and we had to glue them together edgewise. At first, this might seem like a very weak joint, but then properly, it is surprisingly strong. Begin by determining which direction the wood was cut. We had to sand off some of the rough wood on the back to see the grain pattern clearly. We matched up the top so that the tight grain was in the center. The wood for the back was chosen for its pleasing pattern. The halves need to match up perfectly so that no light will show through when held up to a light. This way of checking is called candling. Candling ensures that your glue joint is solid. You can use a joiner or rig up a shooting plane, but we found a simple and effective system was to simply attach some plumber's tape onto a carpenter's level. We used a medium grit abrasive on one side and a fine grit on the other side to make a smooth joint. We sanded the edge on one of the halves while using the other half as a base. We considered several different jigs to hold the boards in place while the glue sets. If you plan on starting a small production line, you might consider a system like this adjustable one built with pegboard. We used a piece of composition board for a jig. We propped up the two pieces with a half-inch thick scrap and then hammered in some nails along the sides. This method gave us about the right amount of pressure. To do the actual gluing, we laid down a strip of wax paper underneath to keep the piece from sticking to the workboard. Spread the glue, align the edges, and then remove the stick. Place another piece of wax paper and then secured the joint to keep it from buckling. The back was glued in the same way, but we added a back strip made up of rosewood and holly laminates down the middle. Although we bought our strip from a luthier supplier, one of the students in our guitar making class did design, laminate, and cut out his own back strip. Usually it is a bad practice to wipe up the glue with a damp rag on any surface that will have a finish applied. In this case, however, it was hard not to smear the glue. We joined the pieces while they were in a rough state and then removed the squeezed out glue in the next step when we thinned down the wood.
One tool which we found very useful was a cabinet scraper. It is simply a piece of specially sharpened hardened steel which can smooth and thin wood surfaces accurately. To sharpen the scraper, we honed the edge square and then ran the handle of a chisel to form the burr which becomes the cutting edge. Now the top, back, and sides of the guitar must be thinned to the dimensions specified on our design. You could use a plane or a large scraper. Trying to keep the thickness even across the whole board will be a tedious process. We took our wood to a commercial drum sander. This machine uses large rolls of sandpaper, and within a few passes on each side, the job is done quickly and accurately to within a few thousandths of an inch. If you can't locate a sander, ask a cabinet maker or a hardwood supplier in your area where to find one.
The guitar begins to take shape when the sides are bent. This is also one of the most anxious moments of the whole construction. There are several ways to bend the sides, and we decided to try two different approaches. The bending on the steel string was done in class, and most of the students helped us out. We first marked the sides so we could align them properly onto the form. Then they were boiled in a long stainless steel tray for about 1.5 hours in order to make them pliable. We then quickly transferred the sides to the bending form, one on top of the other. The minor differences in size were later corrected when the sides were placed into the female form. The waist was clamped down first, and then the wood was heated with a propane torch and securely clamped onto the form. Once the wood was in place, we removed most of the clamps, and the torch was used to keep the wood hot and get the fibers to slide into their new position. The torch also helps dry out the wood, and we kept the flame on for about an hour. You may think that this will harm the wood, but setting the torch for a large yellow flame and keeping the torch moving will prevent burning. Of course, the amount of heat needed will vary with the kind of wood you're using. Rosewood is relatively easy to bend using the boiling method, but some other woods, like curly maple, have a tendency to split and burn easily. The sides were dried for a few days on the bending form. They tended to spring back somewhat when removed from the form, but held their shape. We then moved the sides to the female form and clamped them in place.
On the classical guitar, we bent the sides by hand on a hot pipe. The pipe was mounted on a large soldering iron, and the sides were wetted with a sponge just enough to prevent scorching. As you can see, with firm pressure and a rocking motion, the sides slowly start to take shape. Some experienced luthiers still prefer this method and can sculpt the wood quickly and accurately. To get a smooth bend, we first rocked the wood and heated up an area larger than the bend. When the area was hot, we started applying firm pressure. Only by experiencing the feel of the wood bending can you tell just how much force to use before it cracks. However, we didn't have any problem. When we did discover an overbend, we just reheated the wood and bent it in the opposite direction. Because the sides were then placed in the female form, they didn't have to be completely accurate. However, if you want to build your instrument without the forms, you will have to be more careful.
Probably the easiest method available to the home craftsman to bend sides, especially in highly figured woods, is with a side bending machine. The heat is provided by 3 100-watt light bulbs, and the wood is sandwiched between stainless steel sheets to even out the heat and prevent scorching and splitting. First, one edge is trued up and used as a reference for alignment. Then the position of the waist is determined and marked. After the machine is warmed up for 15 minutes, the side to be bent is wetted. This will create steam which penetrates the wood and accelerates the bending process. The wet wood is placed between the stainless steel sheets with the trued edge aligned with one side of the machine and the waist secured with a bar and spring to prevent shifting. The waist is bent by cranking down on this curved shoe. Springs and rollers are used to smooth the upper and lower bouts down onto the form, and then the ends are secured with a line and cleat. The side is left to cool completely, then it's reheated, then allowed to cool again to set the wood. When the side is removed, it will have a slight spring back. Once we had the sides bent, we put them into the female form. This further set the sides and allowed us to trim them to the proper dimensions. We cut the sides in the form using a coping saw and a small plane.
To prepare the top for the rosette, we decided how we wanted the grain pattern on the soundboard, and then we cut out about 1/2 inch outside of its final dimension. We used a bandsaw and also tried a coping saw. The rosette is the sound hole decoration. It adds character to the instrument and is often called the guitar maker's signature. On the steel string guitar, we used abalone inlay and concentric rings of black and white purfling material. To cut the grooves, we used a fly cutter on a drill press. The cutter was reground to cut the channel to the proper width, and the stop on the press was adjusted so that the depth was just shy of fitting flush. Of course, we had to be careful not to cut the channel too deeply. We glued the abalone and purfling with alphetic resin. Some luthiers prefer to use hide glue, plastic glue, or epoxy, but we had no trouble because there was no stress on the rosette and the finish used over it helped strengthen the bond.
classical rosettes are traditionally a wood mosaic. Several designs are available from luthier suppliers, and so we chose to use a commercial rosette rather than making our own. The channel was cut with a hand circle cutter, the knife was set to the proper depth, again just shy of fitting flush, and the rosette dimensions were cut. The channel was chiseled out. To check the work, we used a straight edge, held a soundboard to a light, and dry fitted the rosette until we were satisfied. Once the piece was glued in, we used wax paper and clamped on a caul to keep it flat. The rosette must be scraped until it is flush with the top. We didn't use sandpaper because it would spread the dark wood of the rosette into the softer wood of the soundboard. Finally, the sound hole is cut out. If you want to make your own, the construction of a classical rosette looks very tedious and time-consuming. Close examination of the rosette shows that the pattern is made up of a mosaic of tiny squares of end grain wood.
Probably the most controversial subject in guitar design is the bracing of the top. The soundboard must efficiently transfer the vibrations of the strings into sound, but it must also withstand the pull of the strings without warping. The technique most commonly used to brace nylon strings is called fan bracing. These fans can be placed in a symmetrical pattern or an asymmetrical pattern. In either case, it's important to firm up the treble side of the soundboard and to provide more vibrating area on the bass side. The tension of the steel strings is much greater, so other methods to reinforce the top must be used. Again, the treble side is stiffened more than the bass, and variations on the X pattern are possible. The bridge plate is installed first. On the steel string, the ball ends of the strings pass through the soundboard and are anchored against this plate, so we used a piece of hardwood, rosewood in our case. For the classical, some patterns eliminate this bridge plate, but we used a long, thin piece centered under the saddle position. For the braces, we used spruce, the same kind of wood as the soundboard. In order to check that we actually had quarter sawn stock, which is important for bracing, we split a piece and inspected the grain pattern. Next, the short braces were glued on. The reason they are installed before the large braces is to allow the chisel some working room when the braces are rounded and the ends tapered off. The large braces were curved in a simple sanding jig. To keep the gluing surface even, these braces should have a radius in them so that the top has a slight convex curve to it. Actually, the finished guitar top may be flat or have a very slight arch, but if you don't radius the braces, you can have a concave top, which is bad. We used about a 20-foot radius. If you can put a belly in the workboard, we recommend it. Otherwise, be warned that the curve in the top of your guitar will be less than the curve you put into your braces. Where braces crossed, we made a lap joint and reinforced it with a cloth and glue patch. At this point, we made a caul for gluing on the bridge. The purpose of this is to spread the clamping pressure and prevent damaging the bracing and the top when the bridge is set. Once the sound box is assembled, it would be very difficult to make this caul.
The function of the guitar back is to reflect the sound created by the soundboard. To provide maximum amplification, the back is curved to a shallow bowl shape. We started by cutting the back slightly oversized, as we did with the top. We then installed a center reinforcing strip. The grain on the strip runs perpendicular to the back and prevents the joint from splitting apart when the back is curved. We made our braces for the back out of mahogany using a straight quarter sawn piece ripped on the bandsaw to the appropriate dimensions. There are several ways to curve the back. Our approach is simple but effective. You can see that the sides tapered from the deepest part of the guitar at the butt to the shallowest at the neck joint. In order to make the back fit the sides, the waist needs to be curved more than the upper and lower bouts. We used this simple template, but the curve doesn't need to be exact. Bending a thin metal rod will give you a smooth, shallow curve to work with. We used a belt sander to shape the braces. If you don't have access to power tools, you can use the same techniques we used to shape the top braces. Just keep the gluing surface as smooth as possible to achieve the strongest bond. Where the cross braces intersected, the center strip was cut away. We made cauls that matched the curve of the braces to hold the back properly curved while the glue set. The braces should be glued in one at a time using plenty of clamps. Don't be tempted to speed up the process by gluing all of the braces before the glue sets, because the stresses on the back will work against the clamps. You want to get the braces on solid. The final step in bracing the back is shaping the braces. We rounded the top and tapered the cross braces at the ends. For the steel string, we used a simple taper, and on the classical, we used a scallop shape.
The tail block is carved from a solid piece of hardwood. We used mahogany for both guitars, but we knew that the steel string needed a larger block to maintain a good balance and provide an anchor for the end pin. The blocks were shaped to the final curve by sanding each block in the form. We used wax paper between the sides and the form when we glued so that the sides would come away from the form easily. The slot you see in the head block on the steel string serves two purposes. It accepts the tenon joint, which we used on the neck, and it allows access to just the truss rod. On the traditional classical design, the sides are fitted into slots cut into the base of the neck.
Linings are needed inside the guitar body to give enough glue area to form a substantial bond. Kerf linings are the most commonly used. A piece of bracewood is cut almost completely through except for a thin web. The saw kerfs allow it to bend easily. This lining is also called a kerfing. The kerfing is glued onto the sides in the form using several spring clamps. When you do this, be very careful to keep the top of the lining slightly above the sides. It's better to sand the linings level with the sides than to have to sand the sides down to the lining, which would change the basic dimensions of the guitar. Once the glue is dry, remove the sides from the form. Taking the bracket off the form helps free up the sides. Some guitar makers prefer other kind of linings. The Spanish method of construction often substitutes individual blocks. Some luthiers say that this allows greater freedom for the top to vibrate if the blocks are properly spread out. Another type of lining is solid, bent in the same manner as the sides. A variation of these solid linings is a laminated lining, using contrasting woods for visual appeal. These laminated linings were the ones we used for the classical guitar.
On the classical model, we made the neck from 1x3-inch stock. Once we determine the angle of the head, 12 degrees in our case, the angle jig is set and the head is sawn off on the bandsaw. We also tried cutting this angle with a handsaw and found that it is relatively easy to match the precision of the power tool. The angle is drawn on the edge and the guidelines are extended down the width. The cut doesn't have to be perfectly even. Next, the pieces were spot glued together and then planed until flat. After separating the two pieces, the scarf joint is glued together and securely clamped to prevent slippage while it dries. At this point, we began to lay out the head. The outline is drawn on and then cut out with a coping saw. We used a simple crest similar to the Torrey's design, but this is another place where you can use your imagination. We traced our design on a piece of rosewood. This laminate serves both to hide the glue joint and to add strength to the peg head. On the rosewood plate, we added a simple maple and ebonized maple laminate to complement our design. We used a coping saw to cut out the peg head. The head angle and the sharp curves make machine tools impractical. To lay out the holes for the tuning machines, the machines must be taken apart. We drilled the holes with a brace bit and a dowel jig, and a piece of tape was used to mark the proper depth. If you have access to a drill press, we recommend using it because the alignment of these holes is fairly critical. Use a brad point drill bit with power tools. Next, we laid out the slots. The slots must be cut after the machine holes to avoid splintering the wood. We also stopped short of drilling completely through and finished drilling from the backside. The slots can be finished with power tools, but a coping saw is completely adequate here. Now the head can be smoothed out with a rasp and sandpaper. The heel block is formed by laminating several pieces of mahogany together. This is one of the major stress points, so we made sure to create a strong bond. Part of the neck on the classical guitar forms the slipper foot or head block. Here slots were cut to allow the sides to mate with the neck. This design required the slots to be cut at a slight angle. In order to make the saw kerf as wide as the side thickness, we used a piece of laminate in the slot and widened it somewhat before working on shaping the foot.
We made the neck for the steel string from a solid piece of mahogany. The profile was drawn onto the blank and was sawn out on the bandsaw. Because of the high tension of the steel strings, the thin neck, and the 14 frets clear of the body, the stresses on this design requires a reinforcement to the neck called the truss rod. The truss rod fits into a groove in the neck, and we used a router table to cut the channel for the truss rod. The strings will pull the neck up, and the truss rod is needed to counteract this pull. The truss rod design we use allows some adjustment to the neck by turning the nut and the end of the rod with an Allen wrench. We decided to install the rod so that the adjustment can be made through the sound hole. Many guitars are built with the adjustment nut under a plate on the head. This allows for easy adjustment and replacement of the rod, but we felt that it detracted from the smooth lines of the design. There are a variety of ready-made truss rods available, or you can make your own. Some builders prefer to use a non-adjustable rod made of a very stiff material, such as hardened aluminum or graphite, while other builders combine truss rods to control any twist they may develop in the neck. This one-piece neck has an aesthetically pleasing grain pattern, and the color of the wood blend perfectly. However, the disadvantage of this kind of construction is that the head-to-neck transition is weak because of the change in grain direction. In order to strengthen this area, we laminated the head with a piece of rosewood. The head of the steel string was much easier to make. The only holes needed were the ones for the tuning machines. We then roughed both necks into shape, using long-handled chisels to work on the heel. These chisels will save your knuckles from hitting the wood. A 1-inch chisel was the most useful, along with a rasp. Some builders also use gouges and power shapers. The object here is to get fairly close to your finished dimension. We save the final shaping for later.
At this point, we glued the sides and the neck of the classical guitar. To prepare the workboard, we trimmed the board so that the neck rests flat against it. The sides and the neck are then glued together, allowing for the thickness of the top and using wedges to make a tight joint. These temporary wedges are then replaced with wider ones, which are trimmed flush. To protect the exposed end grain on the foot from absorbing moisture and splitting, we sealed the wood with a coat of shellac. Before we attached the soundboards and the backs on our guitars, we had to sand the linings and sides to accept the plates. Because of the curvature of the top and back, we had to use a scrap block to give us the proper angle. We also used a scrap block to sand the head and tail blocks. After cutting the plates to size and trimming back the braces, we cut notches into the linings to accept the braces. On the curved lining, we simply removed a few blocks. But on the solid linings, we had to cut notches. Because we wanted to maintain a solid structure, we trimmed very little and kept checking for a tight fit. When gluing on the plates, we used these spool clamps, which we constructed out of a threaded rod, a 1-inch dowel, and some wing nuts. We discovered that by using several of these clamps around the perimeter of the body, we were able to apply controlled pressure. In the classical design, the neck is aligned when the top and the back are secured to the slipper foot. To do this, we use the workboard when we assemble the sound box. The neck is clamped in position before we attach the top, and the angle of the foot is then sanded to its final shape. One trick we used to align the neck was to put a couple of nickels under the neck body joint when we attach the back, to give the neck a slight angle. The nickel's 2 millimeter thickness gave the angle we wanted. The back is glued on after the soundboard for these reasons. Because the back is made of hardwood and has a pronounced bowl shape, it would distort the sides without the soundboard counteracting this force. Also, you'll find that it is easier to clean up the glue on the back by working through the sound hole than by trying to clean up the inside of the top after the sound box is assembled. On the classical guitar, we trimmed the excess with a chisel and used a router with a flush cutter for the steel string. Finally, any remaining bumps are sanded out.
At this point, both guitars were ready for purfling and binding. The binding is a strip of wood which seals off the end grain of the top and back. Many guitar makers add purfling made of laminated wood to the bindings for decoration. We use commercially available rosewood bindings with holly strips and a black and white laminated purfling for the soundboard. On the steel string, we used a router table with a guide to cut the ledge to the correct depth and width. We managed all right with an ordinary straight cutter, but special cutters with spiral flutes are available to keep the edges from fuzzing up. To prevent the possibility of tearing up the grain, we worked from the balance in. On the back, we added a cardboard spacer to compensate for the curvature. Because of the slot used in the neck joint, we had to take special precautions on the head block area of the steel string design. Since the classical already had the neck attached, we cut the ledge by hand using a luthier's purfling cutter. Although it takes much longer to use than power tools, the hand cutter makes a very clean and accurate channel. We alternated between the cutter and a chisel. Probably the quickest way to cut the ledge is with a special set of cutters and wheels for the router available from luthiers and woodworking suppliers. You can still make some fine adjustments to the width by wrapping tape on the wheel. If you use a wide purfling, you will have to make the ledge the shape of an inverted L. This type of channel is also stronger, so the effort is well worth it. Here you can see that the cut extends all the way to the linings and part of the braces have been trimmed off. Be careful here, if the binding and purfling channel is too wide and too deep, the top will drop right out.
To inlay a decorative strip which matched the bindings, we cut a channel in the butt of the guitar. Secure the sound box to the workbench while you mark, cut, and chisel the slot. Some makers use a tapered piece of contrasting material, which is easier to install. Others leave the joint alone, but in either case, your seam must be very tight. We used a hot pipe to bend all the bindings at one time. If you omit this step, the gluing process becomes a nightmare of broken wood strips, unless your binding material happens to be very flexible. We glued the strips on in one operation, but for complex designs, you would have to do this in several steps. The holly strips were trimmed at the bottom with miter joints. We held the bindings and purfling in place with the large rubber bands until the glue set, using several bands to apply adequate pressure to reduce the possibility of gaps. A furniture clamp provided some extra pressure on the waist of the classical guitar. After the rubber bands were removed, the purfling is planed, scraped, and sanded flush with the body. A word of caution, we found that the bindings tend to split very easily when scraping or planing.
To attach the neck to the steel string guitar, we secured the neck to the workboard and made sure that every part lined up. Unlike the classical design, this guitar didn't need the 2mm spacers. Once everything checked out, we glued and clamped the assembly together. We followed the construction of this blonde cutaway guitar from the initial concept through its completion. One of the construction features we particularly liked was this neck-to-body joint. A solid head block was installed in the body and the neck were then trued up, and then a splice joint created by routing out the neck and the body. This is a simple and effective way to make the joint. For the fingerboards, we used quarter sawn pieces of ebony. After planing and sanding the blanks until they were smooth and squared, we marked the positions of the frets. Some ready-made aids to proper placement are also available, like this metal fret rule. To cut the frets more precisely, we modified this miter box to hold the saw with the proper kerf width in alignment. The depth was adjusted so that the cut would allow 1/8 of an inch of wood to remain under the fret. This was one of the most exacting parts of the construction, so we made sure to set the position accurately and clamp the piece in place. The job of measuring and cutting the frets can be made very simple with the use of this device. The board is taped to a plastic guide. A guide pin and a mechanical stop holds the fingerboard while the saw is guided in the jig. The depth is also easily adjusted. Whichever method you use, making an accurate fingerboard is not difficult if you're careful.
Next, the fingerboard must be tapered. A guideline is drawn and the taper carefully cut, keeping the fret slot square to the center line. The edges are then dressed with a smoothing plane. Once the fingerboard is glued onto the body, several points should be checked for alignment. The 12th fret on the classical guitar lines up the neck to the body. With the steel string, the 14th fret serves this purpose. The center line must match up, and the board should extend from the sound hole to the nut position. Once these points are found, small finishing nails are driven through a couple of saw kerfs to act as positioning pins. On the classical design, we rounded the bottom of the fingerboard to match the radius of the sound hole. We used a full-length cull to even out the gluing pressure and drilled holes for positioning nails. The nails kept the board from sliding around while the glue set and were removed afterwards. Next, we shaped the fingerboard. We made a fret plane the full length of the fingerboard from a straight piece of composition board. Then we cut sandpaper from a sanding belt and glued it on. For the steel string, the fingerboard is curved to a slight radius, 14 inches in our case. We made a template to help guide this process. On the classical, if you discover that the neck doesn't come up to the proper angle, it can be corrected at this point. After shaping, we went back to the fretting saw to deepen the slots that had become too shallow.
The fingerboard on steel string guitars traditionally have inlaid position dots. For these, we used abalone circles. The cavity was first drilled to a depth slightly less than the thickness of the abalone. A drop of epoxy glued the dot in place. In order to fill the area around the dot, we spread some ebony dust into the area while the glue was still wet. Once the glue dried, we used our fingerboard plane to sand the abalone flush to the surface.
The fret wire is made up from a wire drawn into a T shape and is available from luthier suppliers. The tang of the frets have indentations to grip the sides of the slots in the fingerboard. The crown is the surface the strings are fretted against. We hammered in the wires to install them. Some makers prefer to use wider slots and glue the frets in, but use a minimum amount of adhesive because the frets may have to be replaced in the future. The last frets on the classical design should be split and clamped into place. Hammering in this area could damage the guitar. The frets are then filed smooth and their levels checked. Final adjustment of the frets can be done in the final stages of construction, after the finish is applied.
After the frets are hammered in, the final shaping of the neck takes place. For this phase of construction, we used a variety of tools. One of our favorite was a curved spoke shape. A rasp is also very handy, and when we got close to our desired profile, we used sandpaper. Instead of using specific measurements, we simply shaped the necks until they felt right.
We made the bridge for our steel string from a piece of ebony. The slot for the saddle was cut on a slant with a mill, but a router could also be used to create the compensated design of this bridge. The reason the bass strings must be set further back is to compensate for the sharpening of these strings caused by an increased tension when they are fretted. The effect is more pronounced on the heavier wound strings. Steel strings have a ball on the end, and we use bridge pins to secure the strings to the bridge. The holes for the pins are countersunk so that there are no sharp corners in contact with the strings. Finally, the edges were rounded off and the wings tapered.
We made the bridge of our classical guitar from rosewood. Unlike steel strings, the end of nylon strings are plain and are simply tied to the bridge, so this design is considerably different. The saddle slot is sawn and chiseled out. We carved the bridge by hand and discovered that we had to keep the chisels very sharp to do any sort of wood carving. The saddle in this design is not slanted because there is much less difference between the mass of the wound stranded nylon base and the monofilament treble strings. The strings are tied to the tie block of the bridge. A couple of bone strips protect the wood. We found that the bone was easy to saw to the proper dimensions and epoxy into place. We use long drying epoxy because the 5-minute variety tends to remain rubbery. After the bridge was sanded smooth, we drilled the holes for the strings.
With the bridges completed, we had to decide whether to glue them on before or after we applied the finish. Since we didn't want to finish on the steel string bridge, we glued on the bridge after finishing the guitar, but only after making a mask to keep the bridge area clean. We applied a piece of masking tape over the bridge area and carefully positioned the bridge. Once we were satisfied with the location of the bridge, just slightly beyond the scale length, we immobilized it and drilled holes for positioning pins made of toothpicks. By following this procedure, we were able to avoid scraping the finish off the top, and the pins kept the bridge from sliding off when we glued it into place later. The positioning of the classical bridge was similar, but we glued it into place now so that the bridge would receive a finish along with the rest of the guitar.
We wanted an added touch to the steel string guitar to set it apart from the factory-made dreadnoughts, so we decided to add an abalone inlay to the peg head. One of the students in our guitar making class was experienced in inlay work and agreed to help us. She first drew out a design which was compatible to the peculiarities of working with a thin sheet of abalone shell. Here the paper drawing is glued onto the piece of abalone and the outline carefully sawn out with a jeweler's saw. She then spot glued the cutout on the peg head and scribed the outline with a sharp knife. After removing the piece, she worked over the scribe line to make it more visible. Using a Dremel motor tool with a router attachment and a small router bit, she made the cavity for the inlay a depth just slightly less than the thickness of the abalone. The corners had to be cut with a chisel, and during the final carving, the fit was checked repeatedly. She mixed some rosewood dust into the epoxy mixture. The epoxy was a longer setting type, which dries to a very hard finish. This mixture fills into the gaps. The lines she sawed out gave the inlay added dimensions as it filled. A piece of wax paper prevented the cowl from bonding to the peg head, and gentle pressure was used until the glue set. Finally, we sanded flush to the surface.
The guitar may look to be nearly complete at this point, and it is true that if you strung it up now, it would be playable. A tedious but very important step remains to be completed. The guitar should be meticulously inspected and prepared for finishing. Beginning woodworkers tend to hurry up the finishing process, where an experienced luthier may spend almost as much time in the finishing process as he does on the construction. To prevent dust from accumulating in the sound box, we used a modified plastic container and a sponge to seal up the sound hole. We repaired the gaps that appeared between the bindings and the body using steam from a tea kettle and a furniture clamp. We used a cowl to spread out the pressure and left the area clamped until the glue set again. Any minor gaps were then filled using lacquer sticks. The sticks were simply melted with a soldering pencil and then leveled with a chisel almost immediately. The important point in selecting the color for the filler is to find one that matches the wood once it's finished. On small gaps near different colored woods, we recommend using clear shellac or lacquer sticks. To fill in large areas, we glued in slivers of matching wood. Although black lacquer sticks are available, we decided to use ebony dust mixed with epoxy to fill in the gaps under the frets. By using the sawdust, we were able to match the texture of the fingerboard. On the classical guitar, our nut gap was a bit too wide, so we used a shim to make it fit better. To finish off the base of the neck, we used a cap made of the same material as the sides and back. This cap also added some extra strength to an area that can be easily damaged. When we began our final sanding, we wrapped a soft cloth around a sanding block in order to protect the surface from gouging. We started sanding with 120 grit paper and progressed to 220 grit until the surface was smooth. To refine the smoothing process, we wetted the surface in order to raise the grain. The raised grain was hooked with a very fine steel wool pad and the surface again sanded with 220 paper. We repeated the process twice until the grain could no longer be raised by further wetting. The final sanding was done with 400 grit paper just before applying the finish. Final sanding should be done no more than 24 hours before the finishing, otherwise dirt and moisture will accumulate in the pores of the wood. To begin the lacquer finish, we masked off the fingerboard because we wanted to leave this area unfinished. Before every coat of lacquer, we used a tack rag to pick up any dirt that might have accumulated on the surface. We sealed the open pores of the wood by brushing on heavy coats of sanding sealer. Some builders prefer to use paste wood filler, but it tends to stain the natural color and would be difficult to use on a design like ours, which has a thin strip of contrasting wood. A better solution is to use a thick transparent filler. The sanding sealer takes many coats to adequately fill the surface. Between sanding sealer coats, we sanded the surface smooth and cleaned up with a tack rag. The lacquer can be applied with a brush, but the most accepted method is by spraying it on. We didn't have access to spraying equipment or a spray booth, so we used pressurized cans. We highly recommend using good quality lacquer and equipment if available. Although the lacquer dries quickly and was ready for another coat in about 15 minutes, we were very careful not to apply too many coats in quick succession because it takes several days for the lacquer to dry completely to a hard finish. We allowed the finish to cure for 2 weeks before we rubbed out the finish to a high gloss. All the surfaces were first sanded with 400 wet sandpaper and a drop of dishwashing liquid dissolved in warm water to help lubricate the sanding. We then used a medium polishing compound rubbed out with a piece of soft cheesecloth, followed by a fine compound. The final polish was brought up with a wool bonnet on a power drill.
Although tungsten oil is seldom used as a finish for guitars, we found it a simple yet beautiful finish which didn't hurt the acoustic properties of the instruments. Oil finishes are usually allowed to soak into the wood before the excess is wiped off. However, the finish on a guitar should be as thin as possible, especially on the soundboard. So we used a different method of application. We put some of the thick oil into the bowl. It's important to keep the liquid clear of any lumps by straining it. We used some cotton material wrapped in cheesecloth to spread the thick oil over a small area, about 1/4 of the surface at one time. Then it was wiped off immediately. The wood absorbs enough oil to build up the finish, but the penetration is controlled so that only a thin layer is deposited on the surface. After all the surfaces, including the fingerboard, were oiled, we hung the guitar to dry for a day. We protected the bare wood from picking up any dirt or oil from our hands by using an old sock as a glove. In between coats, we used fine steel wool to smooth out the finish. Because the steel wool can take the finish right down to the wood, we used very light pressure. After cleaning off the dust and loose steel wool, we repeated the oiling process. We found that the body needed 4 coats of tungsten oil and the soundboard needed 5 to 6. The reason for this is that the body is made of porous woods which absorb the oil, while the non-porous top allows the oil to build in very thin layers. Once we were satisfied, we allowed the finish to cure for 1 week before rubbing out the finish. To protect the oil finish, we simply used steel wool until we had the desired sheen, and then applied a lemon oil mixture to all the finished surfaces. The lemon oil evened out the finish and formed a protective coat. This finish is waterproof and very easy to maintain. An annual application of lemon oil is all that will be needed. If the finish gets scratched, the affected area can be smoothed out with steel wool and then tungsten oil applied to repair the damage.
We finally had the guitars built and finished, but a very important painstaking task still remained before the instruments were playable. This process is known as setting the action. On new guitars, the action needs to be further adjusted after a few weeks with the strings at concert pitch because the wood settles in. This is also true of older instruments, which may have changed through the years and need some tweaking. We checked the frets with a straight edge and tapped down any high ones. Once they were level, we ran a flat mill file lightly over the fingerboard to ensure that everything was even. The ends of the frets were filed to eliminate any sharp edges. And finally, we used a special fret file with a radius on the cutting edge to recrown the frets. Next, the tuning machines were installed on the peg heads. The machines are secured with small wood screws which can strip or break very easily. We drilled out the holes to prevent any mishaps. The nut was measured and cut to size so that it made a snug fit between the fingerboard and the peg head plate. In order to mark the proper height, we used a wooden pencil that we split in half lengthwise using the sharp point to mark the location of the bottom of the strings. The nut was ground down to within 1/16 of an inch of the line and then tapered back about 10 degrees. Likewise, we rounded the saddle into shape, tapering back the top bearing surface to prevent the strings from buzzing. However, we left the saddle taller than necessary until a later step when the playing action would be adjusted. With the nut and saddle in position, the two E strings are now attached. On the classical bridge, the ends are tied in place and the slack taken up by the tuning machines. Before stringing the guitar, the bridge on the steel string needed to be drilled out. To make the tapered bridge pin seat tightly, we used a reamer for the final fit. The slots for the strings were then made with a coping saw blade. Then the ball ends of the strings were inserted into the holes and secured with the pegs. Measuring from the edge of the net, we marked the position of the first and the sixth strings. The classical design requires slightly more space between the high E string and the edge than the low E. This allows for pulling the string while playing without having it slip off the edge of the fingerboard due to the low tension of the nylon strings. We cut the slots with a razor saw. For the larger strings, we had to use a rocking motion to enlarge the slots. With the first and the sixth string in position, we put the rest of the strings in place. We measured the locations to find their relative positions on the nut, but we also set them visually. If we had only used a measured distance between the strings, they would be off because of the different thicknesses of the bass and the treble strings. To shift the strings into their final position, we sawed at various angles until they were seated properly. Satisfied that the strings were where we wanted them, we continued to saw and file the slots until they reached our pencil line. The nut was removed and ground down so that the notches were no deeper than half the diameter of the strings. If the strings bind in the slot, they may break. Next, the saddle is shaped to provide the proper playing action. To set the action, we measured the clearance from the strings to the 12th fret and kept removing the excess from the saddle until we had the desired playing action. The bass strings need greater clearance than the treble, and on the steel strings, the saddle is shaped to a gentle curve to match the radius of the fingerboard. We fitted the steel string guitar with a pickguard. The pattern was attached to the protective covering of the plastic pickguard material, and the design was cut out with sharp scissors. We used a strong spray adhesive to bond the plastic to the body.
Here is the finishing touch on the guitar. Design, date, and apply the label in the sound box. This marks a stamp of approval from the luthier. The label design is a highly personal statement of the proud builder.